Well, it is great to see you this morning, and just so you know, I am feeling okay, all right? I've had several people ask me about that, and just I thought maybe I would use it for a prop in my message this morning, but then I'm not so sure I will, so we'll just see what happens. But I am feeling okay, and those on the front row especially here, you're okay. Don't worry. Hopefully there'll be no projectile regurgitation of breakfast here this morning. That wouldn't be good. But it is great to welcome you here this morning. And earlier this summer, we've gone a lot of different places and still a few other places yet to travel to. But daughter paid a visit to Megan, and one of the things that she asked me on a walk that we were just kind of doing there in Kansas City was, what new thing are you learning about Jesus in your life? I had to take a few steps in thinking about that. And maybe that's a good question for all of us. What new thing about Jesus are you learning in your life? And I guess, you know, I thought about that, and that question has kind of sparked the messages I've done now for the last several weeks, well, 3 weeks or so, on the gentleness of Jesus and just really seeing inside the gentleness of the Savior. Also, the furious love of Jesus. We dealt with that last week, and that's important, I think, and to see that come through the emotional side of Jesus. And then today we're going to look at the authority of Jesus, feeling the weight of who He is. And the way I answered that question when Megan asked me was, you know, I've really been thinking about the anonymous years of Jesus, because we hear about Him in the birth narratives. We go to 12 years of age, and then we hear about Him again. And it's just a very brief encounter, but a powerful encounter in the temple at 12 years of age, at the time of His bar mitzvah. And then we don't hear really much from Jesus until about age 30. And so I've just been thinking about all those anonymous years and how Jesus demonstrates in all of that how important it is to get up and go to work every day. He was a carpenter, and so he got up, he went to work every day. He prepared meals, or was maybe part of that, enjoyed meals. He went to weddings, he did funerals. He just lived ordinary, everyday life. And by doing it that way, he shows us that that is the essence of life. And that part of life isn't to be overlooked. And we are to embrace the everydayness of life and all those things that we do. Some of the monotonous, repetitive things that we do are sacred when they are offered in a way back to Him to lift Him up, and also in ways to get to know Him even better. And so I know for me that for me to thrive in my spiritual life, I almost need to constantly be learning something new about Jesus or about His Word. And so hopefully this series will help kind of focus us on some of those maybe areas of His life that maybe help give us a new insight. And this morning, we're talking about the authority of Jesus. And I realize, you know, I was thinking about using this for a prop. I was going to come out and just kick it, and there's some bottles in there. It's going to go everywhere, okay? But that, I thought, well, you know, that might alarm you. Maybe that's not the way to get this thing started and off the runway this morning. Who knows? Maybe there'll come a time I'll kick it. I don't know. But Jesus does something really, really powerful in the passage that we're going to be looking at today. And I guess we could call it a house cleaning message, where He cleans house. And He has the authority to do it. He has the power. He was always aware of His relationship with the Father. The Father had empowered Him to do the task that He had in front of Him. And one of the things that we just sang about was the love of Jesus. And part of the love of Jesus is that He's willing to extend Himself to do something no one else was willing to do in order to confront the heavily entrenched religious establishment of his era and of His time. He was willing to go up against that in such a way that you and I and people like us could understand God a little better, could see what He was about a little more clearly, and hopefully experience the love of Jesus, the love of the Father, in a more significant way. And so He takes on the religious establishment. He takes it on in the name of the Father, and He confronts it. And sometimes it's important for us to feel the weight of who He is. And if we get nothing more out of this message, just know that there are times when it's good and it's appropriate and it's right for Jesus and the fierce intentionality of His life. That's another little aspect of Him that I think I need to know more. And I want to know Him. Oh, I want to know Him. And so this is one of the ways that I think I'm learning a little more about Jesus, and especially as I've been thinking about that Megan, my daughter's question, what's something new you're learning about Jesus? And I'm seeing this fierce intentionality in His life. He was so intentional. He was so purposeful. Furious in love, gentle and kind, but very focused. He was a man on a mission, a juggernaut of truth. And He lived His life not in anger, not in frustration. What we're going to read about today is not just some out-of-control Jesus who had something bad for breakfast and so He gets up and takes it out on the world. No, it's not about that at all. It's about a Savior who very clearly understood what His mission was. And in fact, there are two temple cleansings in the Bible. There's an early temple cleansing, which is what we're going to look at today. There's a latter temple cleansing that happens during the week of His Passion Week when He's eventually arrested and crucified. So His ministry basically, roughly, is bookended by two temple cleansings. By two moments in His life when He, I'm not going to say He staged it all together, but He planned to be dramatic with this fierce intentionality because He was saying something about how mankind approached God. He was saying something about how the sign on the door of the business of religion has now been flipped from open to closed. That He, in some powerful and incredible and authoritative way, that He has the authority to come in and say, this is my house, this is what we're going to do, I'm closing it down, I'm shutting it down, because I am the new temple. I am the new means by which God is going to interact with the world. I am the new temple. And He has the authority to do that. And this morning, if I just wrap this message up right here, I would just say to you, we all need that kind of authority in our life. That He has the authority to come into your life. He has the authority to tell you how to live. He has the authority to tell you what to believe, how to relate to people, what to give your life to, what to do with your resources. He's got that kind of authority, and it's important for us to feel the weight of who He is. And somehow when we see that and we understand that, we do find a gentle Jesus and we do find a Jesus with fierce love, but we find also an authoritative Jesus. And it's important for us to feel the weight of who He is. And so we're going to talk a little bit about house cleaning this morning and how that Jesus comes in, He cleans up, and does it in a very powerful way. I know none of us really like house cleaning. When I was a kid, I was youngest of five. There's Randy, Becky, Jeff, Rob, and little Joey. Okay? Five of us. And Becky's the second born. And on Saturday morning, we knew the routine. She would shoot us all out of the house. And she locked the doors and wouldn't let us come inside because she and my mom were going to do some house cleaning. And we were always coming right in behind them, messing them up, I guess. And messing up what they were, undoing what they were trying to do. And so she'd lock us out. And then Jeff had the wonderful idea that he would slip in and open window that she forgot to lock. And when he got inside, finally, they were just young, okay, little guys. He comes in with a haymaker just as she turns around, pops her right in the mouth. Yes, he did. And there, she had a little place on her lip for the longest time because Jeff got ticked off because she locked him out of the house, okay? But you know, we don't like when we house clean, okay? We don't like it to be stuff get messed up. We don't like house cleaning, but sometimes we got to do it, right? It's important that we house clean our life. A lot of people didn't want this job, but Jesus, like I said, with fierce intentionality, takes it on. Now, it's kind of interesting to me because years later, my brother Jeff, he grew up and he got nicer. Okay, don't worry about it. He got nicer. And he recently retired. And he was telling me one time in his educational career how he was a vice principal, I think, of a middle school at that time. And you know what vice principals, one of their primary jobs is to be the discipline enforcer, right? I mean, they've got to drop the hammer sometimes. And there was one belligerent guy, he wouldn't listen to anybody, he came in the office so many times. And so Jeff told his administrative assistant, you know, there's going to be some noises and things on the other side of this wall. Don't get too concerned. I'm just having a problem with the same person. I got to get a message across. I can't seem to get his attention. So when the door shuts, he goes and he kicks the can, kicks the door or the trash can. Stuff goes all over the place. He had his attention. And that is kind of what is happening in John chapter 2. Is that this? Jesus has gone to the temple many times. He's been the Passover, part of the Passover festivities many times. He has seen how this temple thing works. He's watched it for many years. And he doesn't give an explanation up front, and that makes it kind of hard for us to understand it. But he stages a situation here where it looks almost violent. But you got to look a little closer and you'll see kind of what he's about. He stages a situation where he wants the attention. He wants all eyes on him. Because he's about ready to launch into something that's going to make a statement for not only them, but for the world. And so he stages this thing in a way, and he sees what's happening. In fact, I thought what would be really cool is before we would get into this even further here this morning, that if we would have our guest to read the entire verses before I actually launch into it. So I think we're going to do that. Go to the next slide if you would for me. And Pastor Raquel, you are here. You have a microphone, and everybody's happy in Jamaica, right? We're all happy. So with such a tough passage, I'm going to have a happy person read it for me. Why don't you read it for me?
Thank you. The gospel is according to St. John chapter 2, from verse 12 through to 22. Here beginning the gospel reading. After this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and brothers and his disciples. There they stayed for a few days. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables, exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." His disciples remembered that it's written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then responded to him, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." They replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. This is the gospel of Christ.
Amen.
We say praise be to God.
Yes, good job. Thank you. Awesome. And a question I have after that reading from a Jamaican sister in Jesus, Raquel, is it ever right to kick the trash can? Is it ever right to confront some things in our life with a fierce intentionality? Is it ever right to take a closer look and to be willing to do what no one else seems willing to do? You see, after this, the text says in verse 12, slide number 2, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and brothers and his disciples. And so the question I got is, after this, it says, so after what? What is it after? And if you look earlier in John chapter 2, you're going to see that there was a wedding and Jesus turned the water into wine. And so what John does, he does something very unique to him as a gospel writer. He's the only one that does this. He shows you the miracle of the wine, and then he couples that with the temple cleansing, and he's the only gospel writer to do that. The rest of the gospel writers will write about the second temple cleansing, not the first. And so he puts those two together, and so John, he puts them together, the wedding and the temple, the changing of water into wine and the cleansing of the temple. And so the point is, he puts them together and he says, after this. And so he sticks them together because on the surface they look like they're utterly different. On one hand, at the wedding feast, you have a Jesus as the greatest party maker in history. I mean, come on. Can you imagine all the people saying, hey, do it again. Turn water into wine. Hey, do it again. Let's go. Man, he is a party maker, right? The biggest in history. And so, but in the temple, the very next sequence or story, you have Jesus as the greatest party pooper in history. So he goes from party maker to party pooper, right? And so it seems like, wow, this is crazy. But then what we got to keep in mind, it's the same Jesus. It's the same Jesus. If Jesus comes into your life, he will, on the one hand, sometimes fill your table with a feast. And at other times, he will turn your table over and spill everything onto the ground. And it's still the same Jesus, and he still has the same authority to do that. He comes through at the last minute sometimes. He answers prayer. He does exactly what we were hoping he would do. And then other times he messes everything up and he spills it onto the ground. And that's the essence of the spiritual life. And maybe you came today, maybe stuff has been kicked, tables have been kicked over in your life. But Jesus works in the kicked over stuff sometimes. And so they stayed there for a few days. And then verse 13 says, when it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And John notes it's a Jewish Passover because he's writing for people that maybe didn't have that frame of reference years after the event. And so what we learn is that the Passover was one of the required annual feasts for all the Jews. And everybody was supposed to make it if they could, especially all the men. And then if they couldn't, they would sometimes send the temple tax and things via neighbors and other family members. But they were all to make it each year if they could, and certainly within their lifetime, to make it to Jerusalem at least once for a Passover. But it wasn't just about the journey. Every Passover, every Jewish house, no matter where it was, went through a ceremonial spring cleaning. Covers were scrubbed. Walls were wiped down, floors were swept and reswept, and it wasn't necessary to get rid of the dirt. It was part of their way of annual reminder, reminding every Jewish family of the Exodus, and it reminded them of the hurried departure in the middle of the night. It reminded them of the rushing to bake bread for the journey. And since there was no time to wait for the dough to rise, yeast was removed from the recipe. And so from that moment on, removal of the yeast became part of the Passover tradition. It's kind of interesting. The night before the Passover meal, the father would light a candle and lead the family in a final inspection with that candle. Every corner was examined, every drawer, every utensil. It was a solemn ceremony as that father would lead that family throughout that home. And so every Passover, every Jewish house was immaculate, except for one. And in the hurry of preparing for the holiday, one house was overlooked. And Jesus called it my Father's house. It was the one that no one was willing to clean up. And furthermore, no one really felt like maybe they had the authority to do what Jesus does here. And Jesus steps in and he says, okay, all of you guys have these spotless, immaculate houses. And you're kosher. Well, you're within the annual traditions and the feast observance of the Jewish tradition. But there's one house that's messed up and it's in disarray. And somebody with authority has to come into this thing with a fierce intentionality and do some deep cleaning. And so Jesus does dramatically. He does the unpopular to accomplish the unforgettable. And so what I'm saying to you this morning is that so one of the aspects of Jesus' life that we need to see is aspect we need to apply to all of our lives. And what areas of your life need house cleaned? If you deep cleaned, and of course yeast was kind of a form of typology, and people have done studies on that, how it's kind of a form of sin in our life and things, and there's little yeast that can get a start in our life, and it can begin to work its work in our relationships and the way we live our life, and before you know it, this thing is all doughy, and this thing has gotten out of control, and now we're stuck in some stuff, and there's just, what I'm going to say to you this morning is that there's times when Jesus comes in an authoritative voice, and he says, hey, it's time to clean some things up. In the temple courts, verse 14, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. Okay, if we look on slide number four and five, what you're going to see here is this is the area. And this whole area, it was a huge area. Now, actually, when Herod and things did some of his updates and things on the temple area, it's like 30-some football fields. These areas here would have been like 15, total equivalent of like 15 football fields or so. And this is where they were setting up their wares, okay? And it's kind of crazy because, you know, when all these people would come to Jerusalem, and they come with the idea that they're going to offer a sacrifice per the Passover requirement, they couldn't bring their spotless sacrifice all those miles, right? I mean, if you're going to try to bring a lamb or whatever it is you're going to sacrifice, you try to bring it all those miles, and if it gets hurt, if it gets maimed in some way, if it falls out of specification of the code, then the priest who were responsible for inspecting your sacrifice is going to declare it invalid, all right? And so, and they would do that with, they were very, very careful to scrutinize the sacrifices. Why? Because they wanted you to buy an approved lamb that's already gone through the scrutiny, but at a very high markup rate. And it was things like this that I think really got at Jesus. It really kind of ticked him off. But it wasn't just like, he's not in anger, he's out of control kind of way. This is kind of staged in a way. And we'll see it as we work our way through this thing. And so in the temple courts, he found people selling cattle. Slide number two. He found people selling cattle in that area that I just pointed out. Sheep and doves and others sitting at tables exchanging money. And this thing has gotten so far out of hand, religion has gotten such a foothold that people are just bypassing the whole multi-sensor experience that was supposed to network them closer to God. They were lost in the confusion and the money exchanging and all this, all the other things that had kind of gone along with this. And the high priest's family, many of them were the owners of the vendors and the tables. And so they were getting kicked back and making profit. And this thing was just, this religion bus was just steamrolling over everything that was important, especially internally in the life of a person. Jesus sees it. And so in all the confusion, the noise and the clamor, he says, you guys are missing this. You're missing what this is all about. And when we come to offer these things, we should be seeing something more than just a perfunctory yearly feast that we're trying to accomplish, more than just a sacrifice we're trying to accomplish. We've got to see and understand that maybe I should be the one because my life is so messed up. I should be the one sacrificed. And yet God in His goodness has offered provision for that. I don't love God with all my heart, soul, and strength in mind, and I don't love my neighbor as myself. In other words, I need house cleaned in my life, and why isn't this me, and this is slain, and now I'm spared, and they weren't getting any of that. It was very perfunctory. They were missing the meaning of all of it. In verse 15, so he made a whip of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. And there were pens of oxen and sheep and the cages of pigeons and sellers sitting around them waiting to make a transaction. So he scattered the coins of the money changers. He overturned their tables. And one of the things that's so interesting here in verse 15, it says he made a whip out of cords. And you look at that, it's a rush. It's a reed or a rush. It was something that was used to kind of create an impromptu bedding for some of the cattle or some of the sheep that may have been in the area. And so he kind of gets these and kind of attaches them together. I think sometimes we think that there's leather whips and there's welts and there's blood and there's just all kinds of violence. I really don't think that's what he was after here. I don't think that's precisely what happened here. I think he makes this impromptu whip in such a way that really couldn't hurt anybody, but it could create a lot of pandemonium, a lot of attention. And so, if you get a newspaper, for example, and you just slap the newspaper on the table, if you got a dog or something, then a lot of times that dog will go running. Super scared just of the noise. I think it's what we see Jesus doing here. He's creating a dramatic scene that could not easily be forgotten. And he's made basically a harmless whip that can make a lot of noise. And he's improvised this, and he's on the move in this particular scene. If we go back to slide number four, if you would, for me. He is on the move, okay? So what he's doing is, this is a big area. If you think maybe 15 football fields together, that's a pretty big area. And he takes off, and he's kicking some trash cans over to get somebody's attention. Kind of like my brother did in his office there as vice principal of middle school. He takes off with this thing. And he's getting attention and he's confronting things. And he understands what's happening. And there's a lot of body language in it. And there's a whip and there's nostrils and there's jaws and that's clenched. And there's a face that's flushed. And there's veins maybe in the neck protruding a little. And his heart rate's elevated. And he really moves with power. And he's moving with power throughout this area. And he's cleaning it out. These cattle are going everywhere. The tables are being flipped over. The coinage is going everywhere. I don't see actually people being hurt by this. I don't even see the animals really being hurt by this. This whip that he's made. Okay, so don't get overly concerned about that. Don't let that sidetrack you from the bigger meaning of what he's trying to do. Take on the establishment of religion. And so he creates this scene. And if you have this elaborate system of sacrifices and worship that's going on in the temple daily, and you've got the peasants and hard workers and villages who are being exploited by a big religious wheel that just turns year after year after year without really changing hearts. It got to Jesus. And he said, it's time. I am here. And at the very beginning of his ministry, you have John including this first temple cleansing as if to say he walks right into the heart of the business of religion. And he walks up and he takes and flips the sign over and says, closed. I'm here now. And that's big. And that'll get you killed. That'll get you crucified. But Jesus was courageous. He has a fierce intentionality about him. And he takes it on. To those who sold doves, verse 16 on the slide, get these out of here. Stop turning my Father's house into a market. Notice that he's not mean to the birds. Okay? He's gentle with the birds. He just says, hey, the birds in the cages, get them out. Get them out now. And he just cleans that hole. I mean, he tears up Jack in this area without really hurting anybody or any living thing. John Eldridge calls him beautiful outlaw. So he says Eldridge, let's layer all of this together. The animals would have been panicked in every direction, leaving fresh manure. Their keepers running after them, shouting, trying to get control, which only incinerates the panic. Add the greedy money changers scrambling around on the ground, grasping at their careening coins. Imagine the noise, bellowing of frightened livestock mingled with the crashing of corrals, tables, coins, the angry shouts of incense men, and over this, the shouts of Jesus. It's absolute pandemonium. Someone screaming, fire, says Eldridge, in a casino would not be far from the reality. This was a mega scene. Huge. It's a sustained demonstration. Jesus is a locomotive, like I said, a juggernaut. And he is so fiercely intentional. And yet in the midst of the fury, I find it so intriguing. that he just says to the birds, the caged birds, just get those out. I'm not hurting them. You just get them out of here. We got to think about this differently. And so Jesus cleaned house, didn't he? He cleaned house. And he has a passion to show initiative. Verse 17, zeal for your house will consume me. It's a psalm, Psalm 69:9. It's a messianic psalm. He certainly lives up to that psalm. Verse 18, the Jews then responded, what sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all of this? Slide number 3, what is the sign? And people knew instinctively when he showed up, he had the right to do it. That he had the right to do it. If we go back to slide number 4, you've got the temple police that police this area. This is the Antonia Fortress. Roman garrisons were stationed in here. They kept an eye on all of this stuff. And what's crazy, if anybody else would have stepped into that temple precinct area and tried to do what Jesus does here on this occasion, he would have been arrested on the spot. No questions asked. It would have been taken care of. But that doesn't happen to Jesus. There was something about his life. Something about his authority. Something about his presence. Something about his fierce intentionality that they couldn't stop him. No one wanted to stop him. Somehow they knew that in the life of this individual, he was making a statement that needed to be made, and it needed to be made probably for years. And finally, someone with the courage to step up and do something great, to like take on the big power chain of religion, he takes it on. And he risks everything. But he does it with passion. And what's crazy is this happened early in his ministry. And so you've got these new disciples looking at this guy going ape in the temple precincts. And they're scratching their heads thinking, uh-oh, have we backed the right horse? Are we with the right guy? I mean, what's his deal? Come on, he's going to get us all killed. And so Jesus, in a way, it's a challenge for even his followers, his disciples. Later we're going to see they believed on him. This was part of that. Okay, but here he is, and they're wanting to know, what sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all of this? They know he has authority, and they're like, give us an explanation of what we felt. We felt something when you were cleaning that thing out. It touched us. It impacted us. We were amazed that anybody could have the kahunas to do this. This is crazy. Why? How did you do it? Where does that come from? Where do you get the authority from? And he comes in, and it's as if he says, I have a right to do this. This is my place. And he casts them out without explanation. He casts them out before he even told them why. He let them feel the weight of who he was. I have the right to shut this place down. I have a right to present a new way to think about God, a new way to approach God. Jesus had a power about him, a spiritual authority about him, and they feared his supernatural ability. And most of the peasant people supported him, and so I'm sure they didn't want to interrupt what he was doing on this occasion. And so he's not advocating violence. Don't walk away with that impression. It's not as if he lost his temper and he got out of control. It's not that at all. He's making a statement. He's closing down religion. He bookends his whole life with a temple cleansing early and a temple cleansing late. And everything in between. He's forcing us to evaluate the way we think about God and the way we live the spiritual life. He's forcing us, and it's almost as if, just as he made a mockery out of our concepts of power and the triumphal entry riding in on a lowly donkey, he comes into our place, our esteemed place of religious observance, and he charges right into that thing, and he says, okay, there's a new kid in town. And here's my message. And you know what? The whole nation could have repented right there. And said, you know what? You're right. We see the abuses. We see how messed up this world is. We see you have a right to house clean this thing. And you have a right to house clean our lives. And we want to repent. We want to reevaluate some things. Well, you think they're going to do that? No. No, they had a good thing going, or so they thought. And so Jesus answered, destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days. Verse 19, When they come to him and they say, what authority do you have to cleanse the temple? What authority do you have to act like the temple belongs to you? You act like you own this place, Jesus. You act like, what right do you have to come in here and throw your weight around and do this kind of stuff? We've been doing this for years. You don't have a right to turn these tables over and to create all this havoc and pandemonium. You don't have a right to come in here and flip the open sign to closed and give us something different to think about. How can you act as if you own it? And Jesus says in so many ways, own it, I am it. Own the temple, I am the temple. I am the new way to think about God. And they replied, it's taken us 46 years to build this temple, and you're going to raise it in 3 days. But the temple he had spoken of was his body. And looking back on things, John understood better. And Jesus was offering to them here the sign of his death and resurrection as proof of his authority. And verse 22 says, after he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said, and then they believed in the scriptures and the words that Jesus had spoken. And so here we have it. Passover, 31 AD, a rural Galilean prophet. He's just a little slender candle in a Passover time of year when everybody was cleaning their houses, holding their candles. He's this little slender candle that flamed with zeal so bright. He flamed with a fierce intentionality for God and a right relationship with God in the right way. He had a zeal and a passion for that. And his candle, it burned so bright, and it exposed the yeasty greed. It exposed the traces of hypocrisy. It exposed the seeds of impurity, the remnants of pride. It was doughing up every corner of the courtyard. His demonstration was the cleaning cloth that removed and exposed so much. Ken Geyer writes a beautiful prayer based on this passage, and I'll share a portion of it with you. He says it this way: forgive me for how I have overlooked the many small but pervasive influences that threaten to make a doughy mess of my life. For the small talk that grew into gossip, for the slight stretching of truth that grew into a lie, for the silent insecurities that grew into jealousies, that grew into criticisms of others. Forgive me for all I have tolerated in the courtyards of my life, for the way I have allowed sacred things to become profane. Have we done that? Have we allowed sacred things to become profane and robbed of their true meaning? Sacred things like male and female. Sacred things like life. Sacred things like marriage and family. Have we allowed them to become profane? And who has the authority to straighten us out on some of those things? Well, I think Ken Geyer recognizes. He says, come, Lord Jesus, come to the temple of my heart. Overturn the tables, drive out the money changers, and do what you have to do to make it a place of prayer. Make it a place of worship. Make it a place where you can live. I want you, Jesus, in here. I want you in my life. And I think there are times when we have to realize that it's time to do some house cleaning. And Jesus is the one to do it. You know, I thought, I'm going to Google some of this week. And I'm just going to see, when we talk about house cleaning a life, what are people thinking when they see this kind of thing? Jesus is the ultimate house cleaner, right? And he's the one to do it. But as you think about this in a practical way, and here's what's going to pop up 9 times out of 10, and I'll eventually get to what I want to tell you here at the end of this application, but house clean your living area. Think about that. Maybe Jesus' presence could be felt a lot better if you just take the time to just pick up your living area. In fact, how do I feel when I'm in a room? You may ask yourself that question. Or does it give me the feeling of comfort, relaxation, inspiration, clarity, functionality that I would hope to have from it? Is there too much clutter, either visible or stuffed into drawers and closets? And what bothers me the most about this room? And part of the family strife that maybe I'm experiencing is that everybody is creating a mess and they expect everybody else to clean it up. That maybe this morning, just doing a little house cleaning, literal house cleaning, in your life might be something that needs to happen just to help life go a little better for everybody. That's going to pop up. You know, Jesus believed in cleaning house, didn't he? Everybody else has spotless house. His father's house wasn't spotless. He took the responsibility to clean it. And here we go. Light in history has been made because he stayed on that mission. Here's something else. They'll talk about house cleaning your physical body. The state of your physical body deeply affects both how you think and how you feel. If you skip exercise, overload your body with processed foods, chemicals, you won't feel energized, inspired, alive. Over time, you'll feel drained, and many people experience common symptoms such as headaches, insomnia, irritability, difficulty concentrating, and they don't realize they're connected to the diet and the lifestyle choices we make. And so they'll talk about shaking up your diet. Maybe it's time to ask ourselves the question. Jesus referred to his body as a temple. Maybe it's time we look at our bodies that way. If this is the Lord's temple, if no longer his presence is restricted to a most holy place in an inner sanctuary where everybody's excluded out of that, the time of the first century temple when it was running. If the veil has been ripped and the presence of God has gone flooding out as it does at the death of Jesus. Mark 15. His presence goes flooding out. We all have free access. His presence goes flooding out and it floods out into every life. You are the new temple for him to dwell in. And maybe it's time to house clean that thing. And you'll see people talking about house cleaning the physical body. And Jesus called his body a temple, and it's sacred. It's sacred, and it's a way to worship God. A third thing you're going to see is that people talk about house cleaning their relationships. Maybe, you know, Jesus had family with him, and he had disciples with him, and again, this came early in his ministry, and so they had some hard decisions to make, especially when Jesus goes into the temple courts and throws what they see maybe initially as a temper tantrum on the organized religion. They have some hard decisions to make. Are we going to follow this guy or what are we going to do? And we're going to evaluate our relationships. And house cleaning, sometimes it's important to house clean your personal relationships. Don't underestimate how your relationships affect your mood, your physical energy, your overall zest for life. Your relationships, says one author, has the single greatest influence on your results in life. Be honest with yourself. Be honest with who you're hanging out with. Young or old, wherever you are, be honest. And they say you can't expect your friends and family to change, but you can respect your journey and take responsibility for your own actions. You can make conscious decisions to who you hang with and who your relationships are. And so sometimes we may have to house clean our personal relationships. And a good question to ask this morning is am I toxic to other people with my own bitterness? Have I cluttered up the sanctuaries of other people, their minds and their lives and their living spaces? Have I chosen to clutter it up with my own bitterness and my own sad perspective? Am I ruining relationships because I'm all about making a profit or getting my agenda move forward no matter who tramples on it? House clean your personal relationships. House clean your physical body. It's a temple. House clean your living area, literally. Sometimes that's a ministry. House clean your workplace. They'll talk about that. House cleaning your where you work and how you can improve your team and you can organize yourself better and you can demonstrate a can-do spirit and a helpful attitude. And if you're a boss, you don't have to crack the whip too hard. Just lay it out there. Make it clear what you expect and need and then follow up. Jesus followed up. And it's important to do that. He followed up. Evidently, from the first temple cleansing to the second temple cleansing, there was a 3-year period of time, and the same things he confronted in the first temple cleansing, he had to confront again in the second temple cleansing. Do I take initiative at work? Do I take care of things or wait for someone else to do it? Maybe it's time to house clean at your work. And finally here, which is really what I want to emphasize, it kind of flows into my area of life, and that maybe, just as Jesus did some house cleaning, maybe Jesus wants to do some house cleaning in your spiritual life this morning. That maybe it's not so far removed to think that maybe it's time to kick the trash can. Maybe it's time to deep clean the house. Maybe it's time to rearrange some priorities. Maybe. And so, is there ever a time when statements should be made or could be made in our life? You know, it's crazy, you know, when we've got five-year-old girls watching 50 Shades of Masochistic Grey with millennial moms. Or we've got teenagers committing suicide after feeding on 13 Reasons Why. Or parents who call an eight-year-old son she and threaten legal action if others don't comply. Or rap musicians that pimp out cars, rape women, and glamorize assassinating police officers. Maybe it's time to kick the can. To make a statement. I got to do that. That was cool. Yeah. I got your attention now. You're like, oh, okay, this sermon just got good. All right. Maybe it's time for fierce intentionality. Not somebody flipping their lid and going nuts and berserk. And we don't need more of that in the world for shallow, empty reasons. No, 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 no. But do we need the fierce intentionality of a Savior who has values at heart, who's doing something great for the world, and He invites us into the process, and He says there's times when you've got to make a stand for something great. Things that are sacred. Maybe it's time to kick the garbage can. When Muslim girls are clitorectomies are performed, sexual abuse of boys by allied militaries, children enslaved in sex industry, celebrity culture with impossible digital enhancements has teenage girls confused and starving and purging. Young men who are perpetually adolescent, unclear on masculinity, taking their thirst for adventure to video games. Hookup culture endorsed by numerous trendsetters, actors, producers, writers, musicians, writers, speakers. They leave college students broken, used, and lonely. I need to get my can. I want to kick it again. Okay? Maybe there's a time. Maybe there's a time in life to feel passionate and zealous enough for something important like parenting your kids. We kick it. Come on, guys. I made sure you were okay. Okay? I was put a little right to that. Didn't want to shank it left. I pushed it right, just a little just right, so you're good. Hey, there's a time to be fiercely intentional, Mom and Dad. I like to say, you don't have to always kick the can, but there's a time to care about something so deeply that you pull a Jesus. And you say, you know what? This way of doing life is closed. There's a new way. And we're house cleaning this thing because I care enough too much for you. And this is good for husbands and wives. It's good for mothers and fathers. There's a time when it's right and appropriate to make a stand. Jesus disturbs the comfortable and He comforts the disturbed. And so this morning, it may be time to house clean your spiritual life. And if so, I'd just like to give you these guidelines. Open your heart and let Jesus in. You got to do that. It would be a tragedy to live much of your life or even your entire lifetime without once seriously considering the claims of Jesus and who He is and the authority that He has to step into your life and tell you some things. It's not just me trying to tell you how to live your life, but there are reasons why we have a Bible. There are reasons why God has spoken. There's reasons why people like Jesus step into our life and they burn bright for just a season. And they show us what life is about and the joy of it and the love of it and the gentleness of it and that there are some things in life worth getting ticked off about. And in such a way that we open our heart and we let Him in and we tell Him what He can tell us what to do and how to live and who to love and what to embrace and where to go in our life with fierce intentionality. He will challenge you to rethink everything. And maybe you're being challenged to rethink some things this morning. So open your life up and let Jesus in. Number two, declutter Number two is declutter. Okay, giving you four or five quick hitting application points here this morning as we wrap this up. We got to declutter some things with the Holy Spirit sweeping through your life. When you invite Jesus in, there's a Holy Spirit presence and He sweeps through your life. And He helps you identify the things that's taking away your peace, the things that's taking away your joy. And He sweeps through. And there's a house cleaning effect that takes place. And it may not be overnight, but there's a house cleaning effect that that has. And you begin to identify things in your life that need checked. Maybe an attitude or maybe addiction or something else that you're dealing with in your life. The Holy Spirit sweeps through and helps you declutter things. We can just confess that stuff to the Lord. Number three is dust. We gotta open our life up to Jesus, declutter some things. Dust, okay? Bad habits slowly build in our own lives. Bad habits, sometimes they just kind of settle down, and little by little, the gossip, the layer of gossip and the dust of laziness or negativity just kind of settles in. And Jesus says, I want to confront that stuff. Let me in your life. I'll help you with the dusting. Sweep is a fourth point here. Bitterness, maybe that's dragging down your heart, harboring resentment toward people. Forgiving them is so important. We just make a clean sweep to clean your soul. For Christ tells us if we're offering our gift at an altar, He says in one place in Matthew 5, and you've got this relational stuff you've not dealt with in your life, get it cleaned out. Sweep it out so that you're free to thrive and know what life in Him is all about. And then finally here is make a plan to keep your soul clean. Air out your attitudes, your anger and cynicism, fear and self-doubt and pessimism and denial and envy and jealousy. If you need to apologize, do that. If you're angry and you're waiting on an apology from someone who won't or can't give it, let it go. Think of any of the grudges that you're carrying and toss them aside. That's part of the plan. Let these things go so that Jesus can have a greater say in your life. The same presence that filled that temple, and like I said, you know, Jesus, I don't think we realized how He was battling for guys like us when He did what He does here in the first century. If you go to slide number five for me, you're going to see it labeled. There's the Antonia Fortress. Here's these areas I'm talking about. What's the name of that area? What's that say right there? Who was allowed? These are exclusive areas, Jews only, and various levels of that. Who are the corner of the Gentiles? Who was allowed in that area? You and me. You see how Jesus was battling for guys like us who felt outside, life all cluttered up with all the Gentile way of life. This whole thing, this whole kit and caboodle, this whole organized deal, structure and everything, was meant to help somebody to see how good God was, how great His provision has been, and how wonderful it is to come to know Him. And they were doing all these other things so that guys like you and me couldn't think straight about God, religion, or Jesus, or anybody else. Jesus was going to battle for you, for me, so that our lives could know something new and relational, dynamic, and real. So that we could care about something in life, care about it enough that we kick a trash can if we have to fight for and with fierce intentionality to contend for the life that Jesus calls us to live. I think that there's some here this morning that like to do that. I really do. And I want to give you the opportunity to do it. Jesus has a right to throw feast at your table and just do the miraculous, turn that water into wine, and He does it, and praise God for the parties. But He also is the same Jesus who, upon closer inspection of our lives, finding yeast that's unbecoming, He says, you know what? I love you, but there's some tough love going on here. We got to kick that stuff out. or this is, your life is going to be so much less. Somebody said when we die, what we do is we meet the person we could have become. And for a lot of people, that's hell. We meet the person we could have become. I can't imagine. But yet, then again, I thought about that more and I can't imagine. And that really touches me. Now I meet another Joey. And he's all grown up. He's loving his wife like he should. He's parenting like he should. He's neighboring like he should. He's just a spiritual giant. I see this guy just glowing. And it's like, oh, that's maybe what I should be. And yet what I am. And it seems such a disparity between the two. And it gets so defeating, doesn't it? Well, Jesus says, I'm going to take all of that, pull it into the present, in the now. Will you let me in your life? Will you let me go to work in your life? Will you view your body as a temple? Will you let me abide in that thing? And will you let me begin to call the shots in your life? And you know what? He has a right to do that. He has a right to throw things around sometimes. He has a right to cast things out. He has a right to take it over. He has a right to live here. He has a right not just to be a guest or a consultant, but to live here, a permanent resident. And Jesus says, if I'm in charge and if I live with you, I have the authority. I have the authority to ask things of you without telling you the reason why. Just let me be who I am. Let me be Lord of the wine and Lord of the whips. And you know what? He has to be. These are both Jesus. He overturns your table and he fills your table for the same reason. Because he loves you. Now you let him slip inside this morning. Let him kick over some tables. We're going to play our final song. And when that thing starts, just grade it back just a little. I'm going to pray for the group. And then we're going to stand together and be dismissed. And then when we're done, you bring her back up. And that can be our benediction for the day. Will you pray with me this morning? All right. Father, thank you so much for this day. And thank you for your love and grace. And thank you for the fierce intentionality of the Savior. We see so much more about what that is heart. And I want to thank you for a Savior who took on the power of religion, the power brokers of religion. I want to thank you for a Savior who was willing to kick over some tables and create a pandemonium scene. And bracket his whole ministry with those two things. I want to thank you for a Savior who renders things closed because he was the fulfillment of all of it. He was all the feast. He was all the sacrifices. He was all the festivals and the offerings and all the different grain and meat offerings, all the other offerings. He was all of it wrapped up. It all converged in him, the new temple. And I don't want to do my life without him. And so I guess I'm missing him these days. But I want to see you more, and I want to know more about you. And I have a feeling there's some here this morning that would like to know more about you. I have a feeling there's some that want to live life with more fierce intentionality. Because that's what you were about. And Father, we don't want to go out here and be violent, and we don't want to go out here and just be revolutionaries without a cause. No, that's not our calling. We see all the other things you did, and we balance all of that out with a life well lived. But if there's those issues in our life, those issues that need confronted, oh Jesus, you take us to those places. And you kick over our table. And you help us to rethink some things, because some of these things we're facing are pretty big deals. They're life altering. You help us to do it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, you stand with me this morning. You've been a great group. Go in His love and His peace. No one leaves sad today. Why? We got a Jamaican in our midst. We're all happy. Let's be happy. Have a great day. Blessings.